Penguin Random House Audio presents The Girls in the Picture by Melanie Benjamin. Read for you by Kimberly Farr. To Benjamin Dreyer, who rescued this novel from the slush pile. Perhaps the simplest formula for a plot is invent some colorful personalities, involve them in an apparently hopeless complication or predicament, then extricate them in a logical and dramatic way that brings them happiness. Frances Marion. Frances, 1969. Lately, the line between real life and movies has begun to blur. There are times when I'm pounced upon by a memory. The cracked rearview mirror of the first car I ever owned, say. Or the ghostly dance of a curtain in front of an open window when I was small and impressionable and plastered in bed with a fever. Or the teasing curve of a man's lips. A man whose kiss I must have known at some time in my life. And the longer I dwell on the memory, the less certain I am of its origin. Is the memory really mine? Or is it borrowed from a movie I've written? Was the curtain dancing because there was an electric fan off camera, trained at precisely the right angle? Were the man's lips curving as they came near mine? Or were they moving closer to the camera lens instead? More and more, I can't always tell the difference. And I'm not quite sure how I feel about that, to tell the truth. On the one hand, it might be easier to live the rest of my days believing all my memories, particularly the bad, were invented for someone else to experience on screen. On the other hand, if I can't claim as my own the memory of Fred's head always ending up on my pillow during the night, as if he simply couldn't stand to be apart from me for even the span of his dreams, how on earth would I ever be able to fall asleep again? And the number of people who might be able to place the memories firmly into either category, real or cinematic, is dwindling. No, not dwindling, Fran. That's a prissy word. Say what you mean. They're dying. Your friends, your colleagues, all the Hollywood relics like yourself, dying off. Like old war horses put out to pasture. Like plants that have hung around far too long in the florist's window. Even on those occasions when I knew that I was most certainly standing in front of a real house, one I had visited many times before, and that I was being cooled by an actual breeze and not studio fans, I couldn't help but touch the rough stucco on the wall just to make sure I couldn't poke my finger through it. And so I did. Touch it. Then I rang the doorbell again. I'm sorry to have kept you waiting, Miss Marion. A liveried butler opened the door, catching me as I poked at the stucco once more. He squinted at me cautiously, as if I really were the dotty old lady I must have seemed. Miss Pickford is not receiving visitors today. You told her it was me, Frances, that I asked for her? For Squeeby? Yes, Miss Marion. Miss Pickford still says she is not receiving visitors today. Is she ill? The butler looked down at his polished shoes and declined to answer. I glanced at my watch and considered my options. Should I walk away, leave, and let the tragedy play itself out? After all, the last time I'd tried, I'd been insulted and thrown out of the house. That time I'd vowed I'd never come back. Yet here I was, trying to revise the tragedy one more time, like a fool. A sentimental old fool. Closing my eyes, I pictured my small apartment, the cool tiled floors, the plush embrace of my sofa, a nice tall glass of iced tea at hand, maybe dozing to the comforting chatter of The Edge of Night or another of my soap operas. Because I really was too ancient for this arduous, thankless business of saving. And where had Mary been when I needed saving so long ago? Here, as a matter of fact, hiding behind this very closed door. So why was I knocking on it now? Shared memories, triumphs, and tragedies. The heroine doing right in the end, despite temptation. All the plots of all the movies I've written tangled together into one gigantic ball of yarn I couldn't begin to unravel. Finally, I tugged on the loosest, biggest thread. Because time is running out. I squared my shoulders, sucked in my stomach, and pushed past the startled butler until I was inside the cool front hall of Pickfair. Where is Buddy? Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers is attending a luncheon. He should be back momentarily. Let me go up to her. Do you know how many times I've been in this house? How many times I've held her hand and told her everything would be all right? No, of course you don't. You're too young. You're an embryo. And I'm a dinosaur, I know. Well, young man, let me tell you plenty of times. The young man, sporting the usual Hollywood tan, paled anyway. Sucking in his breath, he showed his enviable cheekbones to their best advantage, daring to give me a glimpse of a blindingly white, perfect smile. I nearly laughed out loud. Of course, the Pickfair butler was exactly like all the other poor, undiscovered souls in Hollywood, biding time until his big break. Oh, how some things never changed. I know Sam Goldwyn, young man. He's a personal friend of mine. If you want... Of course, Miss Marion, go right on up. I bit the inside of my cheek as I started across the hall. And if you'd like, the young man called out in a suddenly rich, resonant baritone, I'll give you my headshot when you leave. I had to chuckle. Poor boy. He had no idea that Sam Goldwyn was even older than I was, and mad as a hatter at that. Shifting my handbag to my other arm, I set off across the slick, polished floor of the front hall, certain that I would not slip or falter, even though I had seen many people do that in the past. Charlie Chaplin once tied some of Mary's monogrammed dinner napkins to his shoes and skated across this floor, reenacting one of his scenes from The Rink. Mary had looked on with an indulgent smile, the same tight, practiced smile she granted Chaplin in all the photographs and newsreels. But she'd been furious all the same. I could tell by the way my friend's determined chin seemed more determined than ever, rigid with forced cheer. Doug, of course, had not only egged Charlie on, but then had to top him by tying napkins to his shoes and lifting Chaplin onto his shoulders and twirling him around and around, finally throwing the smaller man into the air and catching him, to the delight of the assembled guests. The Duke of Alba had been there that night, along with Gloria Swanson, Rudolph Valentino, Vilma Banky.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.